our Bibles to look up 2 Kings chapter 2. 2 Kings chapter 2. 2 Kings chapter 2, we're going to look at verses 19 through 22. 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 19 through 22. The title of the message is Miracle-ness of Salt. Miracle-ness of Salt. Miracle-ness of Salt. Second Kings chapter 2, verse 19. The Bible says, "And the man of the city said unto Elisha, Behold, I pray thee, the situation of this city is pleasant as my Lord seeth, but the water is not, and the ground barren. And he said, Bring me a new cruse, and put salt therein. And they brought it to him. And he went forth unto the spring of the waters, and cast the salt in there, and said, Thus saith the Lord, I have healed these waters. There shall not be from thence any more death or barren land. So the waters were healed unto this day, according to the saying of Elisha, which he spake." Okay, Brother Caleb, can you please pray for the message?
Faces we haven't seen in a while, such as Sister Helena, thank you for restoring the health, Lord. We pray that you please be with Pastor Jay today as he prepares for the fire, as he gives us your word, whatever he's prepared to preach to us today. We pray that you fill him with the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We know that you're in this, Lord. It's your preaching and you're using him, Lord Father. So, Father, please help us to recognize that and help us to hear him, Lord. Help us to focus whatever we're going through, whatever is happening out there in the world. Please help us to forget it, Lord. Help us to keep our eyes on you and to listen to this preaching. Keep us attentive, faithful for the rest of the day. In Jesus Christ, and we pray.
Amen. 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 Salt. Salt is something that you and I are very familiar with. It's in our food. It's in our system. And it's vital to good health. Your blood, your sweat, and tears have this mineral as well. And salt is essential just for any human being. When we see Elisha's second miracle in book of 2 Kings chapter 2, the water was polluted and it was harmful. Thus he says, you know, water is not and the ground barren. When the water is polluted and water is bad, what happens? You know, it brings sickness to people. I mean, there, if you've seen some documentaries, you know, water sources in third world countries is in very, very bad state. Like places in Africa, their idea of water is some liquid, it dirt in it. And then as you drink that water, you drink those dirt with it. It's never clear color. It's always, you know, like muddy. But that's all they know. And they think it's okay. And one time someone visited them and he had clean water, just like any Westerner would have, whether it's Crystal Geyser or Arrowhead or whatever, you know, water source is. You know, people say Fiji is pretty good. You know, I'm sure, you know, some people love, you know, water, right? And isn't it funny how people can differentiate taste of water? Some people don't care. They say water tastes the same everywhere. You know, but for some, you know, this brand of water tastes better than the other brand. You know, and I'm in the middle. You know, when I'm thirsty, everything tastes good. Yes. But if I really want to taste some good water, you know, there are some brands that are good. So he brought the water to this, you know, African village. And this woman was like, okay, you know, this is our water source. And the guy couldn't believe it. He sees the water source, and it's just muddy water. It's as if after it rains out here, and then we have some, you know, grass in the front, and then water gets, you know, becomes like a little pond there. And imagine you're drinking that water. If I were to tell you, hey, young man, you know, you thirsty? Go over there, get a cup, you know, and then drink that water. And then people have been stepping on it, and it's already muddy, cloudy. And then he was shocked. But he said, okay, this is the type of water that I drink. And then she saw it. And she's like, wow, it's so clear. It's so clean. And once she got the taste of it, you know, can I drink it? He goes, yeah, of course. She drank the whole bottle just like that because it tasted so good. So water is a vital source. And in here, Elijah, his second miracle, uses salt to heal the water. Good. Then you know the significance of salt. He does miracles. You know, spiritually speaking, the fact that you and I are saved is a miracle. Amen. Right? And it's not through feelings or anything. You know, just through the finished work of Christ and through the Word of God. I mean, the land was barren. It was dead. But now it's healed and it gives life. Our life were dead. It was barren. You know, it was just, you know, emptiness. Nothing good comes out of it. And when water source is dead, what happens? You know, nothing good comes off of it. You know, like a living creatures can't really live there because it's polluted. Imagine, you know, you're at Chernobyl, where the site of the nuclear, you know, meltdown. And in there, like, life sources are dead.
Yes.
Our spiritual life, when you look at it before we got saved, it was in total darkness, and we needed some help. Yeah. I mean, we needed a life-giving flow, and that's Jesus Christ. That's why you can't take it for granted, your salvation. I mean, through salt, in this case, people receive, you know, fresh, refreshing water. You know, you and I were supposed to burn in hell, but through Jesus Christ, our death turned into life, eternal life. Then you're in that context, you know, think about it, right? If I'm that miracle, I don't know, when something is miraculous, what does that mean? It's like grand, right? When you hear something, man, that's miraculous. You don't think of something small or tiny. Right, you think something gigantic, you think something, you know, out of this world, you know. But that's what happened to you and me. And when you think in that context, when you think in that sense, you're like, whoa, man, this eternal life that I received from the Lord, not by works of righteousness, not my own righteousness, right, but by Jesus Christ's righteousness, not by works that I have done, his free gift of salvation. Man, this is something that I can't take for granted. Yes. I mean, this is life-giving flow. I have this life because of Jesus Christ. Amen. When you live each day as if, you know, this is a miracle, it's a miracle that I'm living another day.
Yes.
Through grace and mercy of Jesus Christ,
thank you.
Then you're going to appreciate your life a little bit more.
Amen.
When someone is sentenced to death because of their terminal cancer, and you see it around, you might know some people. And you know, I've known a few people who passed away because of cancer. But imagine if they were stage 4 pancreatic cancer, one of the deadliest cancer out there. And doctors were like, okay, I'm sorry, sir, I'm sorry, ma'am. You know, you only have a couple months to live at best. But suddenly, you know, out of the blue, one day, they do this MRI, CAT scan, all this testing, and cancer is gone. I mean, it's gone once and for all. If you're that person, if I'm that person, then every day is a miracle now. This every day is new day, it's miracle. And that person, what do you think that person will do? I guarantee you one thing, they're not going to take new day for granted. They're not going to take new life for granted. They're not going to take anything else for granted. Imagine if you were sentenced to death with stage 4 terminal cancer, but amazingly, one day, like, you're free. You're cancer free. I mean, unless, you know, you're very ungrateful, just, you know, oddball, who doesn't appreciate life or anything else, then, yeah, I mean, there are always people right there. But generally, majority of the people will be living each day more thankful. But as Christians, is that how you live your life? Is your new day an appreciation of miracle that that God has done for you. This city, I mean, who knows what happened to the city, and they will be glorifying God because they had this dead, barren source of water, but because of salt, they received this freshening, you know, new life form in this water. Then salt is a very, very critical component of anybody. That's why Lord Jesus Christ, he said this, right? Let's turn to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5 is famous, very well-known verses. Matthew chapter 5, we're going to look at verse 13. Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. And especially if you trusted Christ as your Lord and Savior now, you know, it is very applicable to you. Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. The Bible says, "Ye are the salt of the earth. But if the salt have lost his savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is henceforth good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid." And as we, you know, apply it, you know, spiritually speaking, devotionally, I mean, you are the salt of the earth. You are the salt. And salt has a savor, and it has a flavor. And as a salt, you have to shine that light to this world. Salt is something that people will be able to live off of, right? You know, people say, oh, sugar, sugar, sugar. Sugar is generally not the best for you, right? People try to cut sugar. But if you see a donut, what happens? And it's full of sugar, right? The best tasting donuts have like a sugar donut, right? You know, everything, cinnamon, sugar. But, you know, salt have a vital functions. And so we're going to look at some of the functions of, you know, salt. Number one, salt prevents rottenness, right? Salt prevents rottenness. As Christians, as you are salt of this earth, you're supposed to prevent rotting of things. You're supposed to prevent rotting of life. You're supposed to prevent rotting of anything as Christian. Not only your life, but other life as well. But so many Christians, instead of preventing rottenness, they are being part of rotten culture. If you know for sure that you're saved, then you have to realize that, hey, you know, I'm salt of the earth. I have a duty and I have a role as a salt to this lost world out there. I mean, Jesus Christ saved you from damnation of hell. And your role is to be out there and bless others and be a good testimony to others. People are dying and on their way to hell. I mean, they're going to rot in hell for eternity unless they accept Christ as their Lord and Savior, trust Christ as their Lord and Savior, come to realization that they're a lost sinner on their way to hell. Then sometimes they need that sprinkling of salt to realize it. Then who's going to sprinkle that salt? Who's going to be that salt out there? Who can be that person that Lord can grab, you know, a bunch of salt and throw it, right? You know, when people are cooking good meat, I mean, we have some barbecue enthusiasts here, right? And if you are preparing some meat, or, you know, if you want to preserve that meat, you throw a bunch of salt in there. Because, you know, salt does the preventing workup, you know, preventing bacterial and spoils, right? Spoilage. Yes. It's an antibacterial measure. That's salt. Throw it. And if Lord wants to be that antibacterial, you know, source to lost people out there, you know, he just wants to grab you and then just throw it, right? That's good. However, if it's a bad salt, it's not going to work, though. Right. I mean, it's not going to work if it's bad salt. If that salt has lost its savor and it can't do anything, what happens? You know, it's good for nothing. Right. Can you imagine, you know, if you're cooking and you're cooking a nice soup and you need some saltiness in it, then you put a bunch of salt in it, but the taste doesn't change. Well, you could be a bad cook, right? But, you know, you're okay cook, and then you're putting a bunch of salt in it, but nothing's happening. I mean, that means that salt has lost its, you know, flavor. I mean, there's an illustration. I mean, there was a man who visited a salt mine, and he broke up a piece of the mineral that had been exposed to the elements. Right? So I'm sure you've seen some salt mines, and, you know, he was surprised to find that even though it had the sparkle and it looked good, it had absolutely no flavor. It had no flavor. It looked like a salt thing. It looked like, you know, and then it sparkled and it just looked like it, right? But digging deeper, he found that the salt, which was still in close contact with the rock, you know, retained its full tang and taste. So when that salt was exposed to the element, it lost its flavor. As Christians, you're getting contaminated by things and mindset of this world. That's why even though you're supposed to be salt of this earth, you don't have any flavor as a Christian. You lost all your flavor. You might have had it in the past. Maybe, you know, when someone needed this salt of blessing, they'll go after you or they look for you. If they needed a, you know, salt of preaching of the gospel, they'll go to you. But however, what happens to Christians in many cases, they get exposed to the element. They get exposed to this world out there, you know, all these temptations, right? You know, devil's pulling you, world's pulling you, and your flesh is telling you, hey, just stay where you are, look like who you are. You are the salt, right? But you don't need that flavor. You don't need that savor. So what happens? So many of you have been so contaminated by this world that you don't even know that you're supposed to have some flavor as a salt. And that happens because you're so backslidden in your Christian walk. I mean, sometimes looks could be very deceiving. You come to church, and then you listen to preaching, do Bible study, have good fellowship. But that's what I'm seeing outside, just like this man who saw that piece of salt, that mineral. However, if I were to dig deeper, however, if I were to try to taste it, maybe if I'm trying to taste your life, I wonder how much flavor it would have. I mean, would it have that, you know, blessing? Would it have that good testimony? Or will it be just full of sin? Will it be full of, you know, pride and selfishness? Good for nothing as a Christian. Think about it. If you only act like a Christian inside a church and not outside of church, there's no flavor.
Right.
I mean, you could try. Maybe that dead salt got some, you know, because of wind, you know, it received some, you know, elements of good mineral from other salt out there. But once that wind goes away, maybe it rains, and then it loses its flavor again. I mean, that's how your Christian walk is. There's a glimpses of, you know, a little bit, glimpses of that good salt in your life. However, once church passes by, once this fellowship passes by, man, you have no flavor. You have nothing. That's why outside of church, you feel miserable. That's why outside of church, you feel emptiness. That's why outside of church, you have zero savor. When you have no savor as a Christian who are to be the salt of the earth, then you're living a life flavorless. You know, what's the worst type of food you can get? Flavorless, right? Like plain Jane Jane, right? You go to a restaurant, you expect this dish to be full of flavor, savory. But you receive something and it's just like nothing. There's no flavor in it at all. It's as if you're expecting to taste spiciness, you're expecting to taste, you know, saltiness, sweetness, but you're tasting nothing. It's like you're just, it's completely watery. It's like you're trying to eat a spaghetti with just full of water on top. Instead of, you know, with nice meat sauce or marinara sauce or, you know, Italian sausage or whatnot, but you have this noodle and all you have is just water poured down on top of it. And imagine you try to eat it. And there's no refund, right? You already paid for it and there's nothing. You can't get anything back and you just try to eat it. And then what happens after you eat something like that? There's, you know, you could be sick, you know, you could feel sick. And, you know, there's distasteful, you know, thing in your mouth. And then you look for something else. Maybe you look for something sweet. You know, you look for another meal, right? If you haven't spent all your, you know, stomach space for that one. Then as Christians, think about it. Are you like that? Are you like that plain Jane, no taste, watery spaghetti out there? Obviously, I don't want to eat, I mean, as in, you know, speaking, I don't want to eat you, right? You're tasteless.
Yeah.
I mean, if someone were to be like, you know, I don't want to deal with you. I don't want to have fellowship with you. I don't want to be with you. Why?
Right.
Because you don't benefit me in any way. And as a Christian, then you're not the light of the world. You're the darkness. You're the same darkness out there. That's why as salt of the earth, you have to realize that, man, I got to give up this savor. I got to give up this flavor at all times. Yeah. You can't be like, okay, only on Sundays, I'm going to give all this flavor, right? But it's not even the best flavor because you've already lost many of its, you know, flavor. Essential parts of all the salt. Then some of you are barely hanging. You have like a little bit of taste left. It's like, you know, I'm eating this spaghetti and I could taste a little bit of saltiness in it, right? It's not the worst thing that I've ever eaten, but there's still some flavor in it. There are hints and bits of, you know, some redness or meat out there. It's not as watery as it used to be. Then you have some chance. Don't let it completely go away, that taste. You're trying to prevent this world, these people on their way to hell from rotting forever. I mean, your role is to prevent, you know, rottenness, right? How are you doing? I mean, that's a simple question. How are you doing as a salt in this world of preventing others from rotting? I mean, how are you doing as a salt in this world from preventing yourself from rotting? Because many of you guys are just rotting, you know, just little by little, little by little, little by little. And there's no end in sight. You come to church, but you're still rotting. I mean, can you believe it? I mean, the fact that you're here should be where your mind is all completely, you know, concentrate on glorifying God, getting blessed from it. But because you've been already rotten so much from things of the world, you've been so polluted by things of the world, you're still rotting.
Yes.
Like the word has no power in your life. The word of God has no power in your life. Even prayer is like the furthest thing from your life. Then you're in trouble. I mean, you have to admit it. I mean, before you can change, before you get help, you have to admit that you have a problem.
That's right.
Before sinner gets saved, they have to admit that they're a sinner,
yes.
Right? I mean, as a Christian, before you get better, you have to just admit, man, I've lost some flavor, if not all of my flavor, you know, as a Christian. I've lost this, you know, flavor that I should have as a salt of this world. That's why when people were to see your life, I mean, do they see light? I mean, do you actually shine to this lost world out there? Or are you that, you know, that dim light or that darkness? Or you're like invisible, right? There's no prevention then if you're invisible. I mean, at least if you're visible, which you should be, people can see you and they'll stop. But your Christian life is so rotten you're so backslidden, people just drive through you. Imagine if you're the last line before the cliff, and you're supposed to hold that sign and say, stop. You're on your way to your destruction. And then we're going to say, that's hell, damnation, eternal lake of fire. And you're supposed to stand right there, right? And if this is, you know, if this is the cliff, and this is hell, and you're supposed to be standing right here, and then you're supposed to stop the cars from, or stop anybody, you know, from crossing that line the best way you can, the best way you know how. But if you have lost your flavor and your savor, you can't be seen. Like, you're not there anymore. Maybe some part of your life you were there. After you got saved, you realized the first love, you're gung-ho, fired up for the Lord. And then you're not just at one place, you're at every place in that line. You know, as people are coming, you get this person, you see that person afar off, you get that person, you see that person, you go that way and you start, you know, you're going to prevent as many people from falling. And that was when you had that zeal and love for the lost souls out there. And you wanted to keep that testimony. You wanted to be a blessing to this rotten world. But now, what happened? I mean, you have become so lackadaisical, lazy Christian, where you don't care about anything except yourself. That means nothing to you. And when millions of people are falling over the cliff every second, all you care about is you, right? So instead of you standing there, you're progressing forward where the devil is, where the world is, where your flesh resides. You're just, instead of protecting that line and preventing as many people from falling into that eternal lake of hell, you're like just going forward and marching on in the wrong way. And then you're missing everybody. And then you're becoming that invisible person. I think the worst thing that, you know, a human being could do, another human being, is just completely ignoring that person, right? When they want to talk to you, when they want to get your attention, and they're just like, you know, they say, like, talk to the hand, right? And then I'm just going to ignore you. I mean, if that happens in a marital relationship, that's tough. Or anybody, right? Or family. Yes. A brother or sister. Like, you're husband is talking to wife, but wife, it completely ignores the husband. And don't care about whatever he says. And then, you know, don't give a flip about it. Then how do you think the other person will feel? I mean, they'll feel terrible. They'll feel like, okay, so you don't even care about me, right? But that's who you are, though, to this lost world out there. I mean, they're talking to you, literally. You know what? I need to get saved. You know, sometimes, you know, I don't know how to tell you about it. You know, I'm a pretty bashful, shy person, but I want to go to heaven. You know, I'm on my way to hell. I'm about to fall out. You know, but I need some help. But it all falls on deaf ears, and especially people here, and people's listening. You know, they're all trying to talk to you. But you give him your hand. Okay, talk to my hand because I have this priority to take care of, right? I have work, I have relationship, I have a bunch of stuff. You know, I have to fulfill the lust of my flesh. So, you know, you guys talk to the hand. And while they talk to the hand, you know, it's time is still moving. They're moving. And then they went past your hand, and now they're off the cliff. And then you're like, you turn around. Oh, another one went down, okay. And you don't even care anymore. You know, you come to the state where you don't really care. You're like, okay, someone else would do it. You know, I lost my flavor, I lost my savor as salt of the earth, but I know that there are all those salts out there, they'll do their job, right? But what if you're that only salt that were able to reach another person? You are the only salt where you were able to prevent that thing from rotting, right? But you caused it. And, you know, I mean, Bible has several verses, right? Be sure your sin will find you out. you reap what you sow, right? I mean, their blood, right, will I require? I mean, you're not going to be innocent, Christian. You're going to be guilty. And at the judgment seat of Christ, depends on how much savor you gave this to the world as a salt of the earth. You got to be judged. I mean, that's no if and buts about it. You got to be judged based on, were you the light of the world as a salt of the earth? Or were you non-salty, ignorant Christian, complacent Christian, selfish Christian, proud Christian, loving the world Christian, full of himself, herself Christian, and you were the darkness to this world? If I realize that, man, it's a miracle that I'm going to heaven, it's a miracle that, you know, this eternal problem has been resolved, it's a miracle that I could face another day by grace of God, mercies of God, well, I'm not going to keep it to myself. I want other people to enjoy it. I mean, can you imagine if there is a formula for terminal stage cancer patients to be saved from that cancer? Because, you know, and you found out about it and it happened to you. If you even have a decent heart, forget about being saved. If you're even an okay human being, you're going to go and tell others. You're going to be like, okay, you know what? You know, man, I know the pain that you're going through. I went through the same pain. I was in your same state. I was lost, and I was on my way to hell. You know, I had this cancer too. And then only miracle would save me, but that miracle happened to me. It's not Jesus talk to me or anything. It's not about, you know, me speaking in gibberish, right? But through the word of God, you know, through the right doctrine, you know, Lord gave me this newness of life, this miracle of new life. And you could have that too. Some people are just waiting to hear that from you. Literally. Well, they're very shy. Again, you know, I'm glad, you know, our church is very hospitable, especially when, you know, new folks come, you know, I mean, old timers come, or even you guys see each other on a daily basis, I mean, weekly basis, you're still hospitable to each other, and hopefully it stays that way, right? But because, you know, there's some, you know, shy people, bashful people out there, but, you know, you reach out to them, even though you're bashful, because you know how that feels like, you reach out. These lost people are out there just waiting. Their reaction might be different. Don't expect to be rosy all the time. Right? Okay, you know, you need to get saved. When a bashful person first receives a greeting from another person, what do you think their first reaction would be? Extrovert, you know, social people will be like, oh yeah, hey, nice to meet you. And then you're already like best friends. But bashful people, they will have a kind of reserved reaction first. Because they need to kind of gauge. They need to, you know, consider the risk. They need to consider, you know, is this okay for me to talk to that person? And then maybe that person's first reaction is not all smiles to you. But inside, they're thinking. They are analyzing. They're weighing the evidence. Lost people are out there. A lot of them are just weighing their evidence. They just don't know how to express it right. But it's for you to reach out to them. If someone out there did not reach out to you, where would you be? If someone out there did not reach out to me, I mean, I'll be in the gutter. Who knows where I'll be, right? I mean, I might have been dead already, right? But because of that one person, because of that one person who reached out to you, Christian, you're here. I mean, Dr. Ruckman, right? Amen. Hugh Pyle. I mean, went to him. And then of course, that led. I mean, Dwight L. Moody, you know. I mean, you have that kind of influence. You have that kind of influence. I mean, that salt, as the salt of the earth, you could give that flavor. You could bring that savor to this rotten world. And then every person can bring that savor and flavor to this lost world out there. If you're home and you have meat, and if it's rotting, it's gonna smell bad, right? It's gonna be very unpleasant. Then in order to get rid of that smell, you could do everything, because you say, I can't throw that meat away, it's so expensive, and it's so high premium meat. Then you put salt in, salt on it, and then you'll prevent it. Then you have to do the same thing. And don't, it's been rotting. Let's not kid ourselves. I mean, just admit it, that your life did not give good flavor or savor for a long time. And it's been rotting. It's been spoiling. Out here, so don't judge by what you see here. You have to judge by what we don't see, what you don't see.
Yes.
It's all about how you spend your time outside of church when people aren't watching. It's all about how you spend your time at home. It's all about time that you spend by yourself. I mean, that's the key. If you, when you're all alone, spend time in the Word of God in prayer, think about lost souls or out there witnessing, you know, dedicating those time to the Lord, then you'll have savor. I mean, you have that great flavor. But for some, or for majority, that's not the case. And we have to make sure that you have good savor. Don't have polluted savor either. Because we have too many Christians out there, you know, polluted by wrong doctrines.
Right.
Yeah, don't be, you know, trying to make that flavor come out with, you know, this doctrine there, you know, all over the place. What happens when you're cooking and you put every sauce out there in there? It doesn't taste the best.
Right.
How do I know? I tried it before. You know, instead of, you know, just putting just, you know, one or two essential, you know, sauces in it, but you feel like, okay, it's time to put, you know, Tabasco, let's put some Tapatio, let's put all this flavor, let's put ketchup, sriracha, everything. What happens? It just becomes like nothing. Bunch of things that you can't really eat, right? But that's what's happening to you too. You know, just stick with the right doctrine. There's so much out there.
Yes.
Just with that single, I guess, I would say like channel where you learn from, the foundation.
Yes.
And then you'll be okay.
Amen.
You gotta be more than okay. You'll be grounded and you'll be strong. There's no reason to bring other stuff in. It's only gonna pollute it. If you wanna keep it pure, then stick with what's right. And sometimes you don't know what's right. That's why you talk to, you know, people who's been in the faith longer, or talk to the pastors and leaders and get that input. I mean, when you're cooking, I mean, there are natural born real good cooks out there. They see ingredients and they just make it on their own. And it's like the, you know, five-star Michelin taste, right? But for majority, we need recipes.
Right.
Yeah.
And we need recipes,
yes.
Right? And what happens if recipe's wrong?
Ooh.
They say, okay, you're supposed to put like 5 grams of salt, but this person said you're supposed to put 100 grams of salt. So they're very extreme.
Yeah.
But when it comes to food, it's not about extreme either. It could be very tiny bit, you know, that could determine good and bad taste. Then you have to make sure that you get the right recipe. You want to use that salt in the right way? Get the right recipe. That's why you need to study in order for you to keep that taste of salt more pure. It has to be constant effort, or else you'll be exposed to the element and you will completely lose it. So, I mean, it's not that difficult to understand. Salt will prevent rottenness, and salt will give savor. And if there's no salt, what happens? There's no taste anymore. There's not going to be any savor in the food. If you're not going to do your job, then everybody around you, surrounding you, they'll never have a flavor, no savor. As a husband, if you don't act as a Bible-believing husband, you're going to lose it. You're going to lose all your savor. As a Bible-believing mother, if you don't act like a mother, you're going to lose it. As a child, you don't act like a Bible-believing child, you're going to lose it. As a grandma, grandpa, you know, as just a saved Christian man and woman, you're going to lose it. If salt loses its taste, then it cannot heal anymore. What's one of the vital, you know, functions of salt, especially in the past? It heals the wounds, right? You soak wounds in salt, purify salt, so that it could prevent it from rotting. Whether it's you, whether it's your family members, whether it's someone that you know, they need some healing in your life. They need some healing in their life. And you're that source who could provide that healing with your testimony, right? With your life, with your countenance. Everything about you can provide that healing. Are you improving the wounds of others, or are you actually making it worse? Because if you don't do anything about it, what happens? They're just going to rot. Their wounds going to get worse and worse and worse. And sometimes I'm telling you, it's your own family members. They're rotting right in front of you. I mean, they don't tell you about it, but you could see. I mean, if you can't see, I mean, maybe you're really, really backslidden. You're like, you know, out there, you know, so close to the devil and the world that you don't even realize it. But for majority of you, you at least have that sense. Man, I've lost so much taste and flavor that I'm really hurting people around me. If you don't realize it, what do you think is going to happen? You go down and they go down with you. And that's the worst part for many Christians and their family, because no one could recognize, or no one would change. No one would listen to the word of God. No one would listen to preaching. No one would listen to, you know, what's the right thing to do. No one would listen to the conviction of the Holy Ghost. So they'll just like, okay, just leave me alone. I'm not going to be the light of the world. Forget it. I know I'll be a tasteless Christian, no salt. And wow, you know, I see that person as a deep puncture and a bruise and a cut. And I could be there, you know, provide the healing, but you know what? No, you know. And you're dying as well. I have a bunch of wounds, right? You know, I have punctures here. I have deep cuts there. And I'm not going to seek any help. I'm not even going to go to the Lord. You know, there are all the souls out there who could help me. But, you know, I'm just going to rot and die just like this. Man, isn't that shameful and pitiful?
Yes.
I mean, that kind of mindset is going through so many Christians right now. And if you're the one of them, I mean, you better really get right with the Lord.
Yes.
You got to, like, wake up. I mean, literally, we should grab some salt and throw it on your face so they could go into your eyes and, you know,
Amen.
You know, like, make it burn.
Yes.
It will be a good burn. And then you, like, wake up.
Yeah.
Because if you don't wake up right now, and if you don't get right, you know, as a salt of the earth, then what's going to happen? You're going to completely lose it, and then you're going to turn into a tasteless salt. And as that man, beginning of the sermon, I mentioned, they'll break it off. They'll be like, oh, it looks the same. Shines like the same. It has the same crystals, but no taste. Then what do you think they're going to do? They're going to throw it away. Why would you keep something that's useless, right?
That's good.
Man, whether you're a hoarder or not, right, just normal, useless things, you just throw it away. or put it aside, right, if you're not going to throw it away. Don't be that Christian. Don't be that useless Christian where you or others have put you away because they see that there's no savor, no flavor from that guy, from that girl, from that child, from that Christian. And after life is over, at the judgment seat of Christ, how are you going to face Lord Jesus Christ? When Lord said, ye are the salt of the earth. Ye are the light of the world. Don't lose that savor. Don't lose the flavor. If you've lost it, get it back.
Amen.
It's not something that's permanent right now, as long as you could breathe. Right?
Yes.
As long as God has given you mercy and grace to breathe, you have to get that flavor and savor back before it's too late. Let's pray. Dear Father, we are to be salt of the earth. However, many of us have lost that savor because we've forgotten how important and vital our role is in this earth. We're to be a testimony to lost world out there. We're to be out there preaching the gospel. We're to be full of word of God. We're to be in the right doctrine, teaching others. And Lord God, but because of our sinful ways and selfishness and pride and laziness and whatever you name it, because of all these sins, we have gone away, Lord. Many have just backslidden. Lord God, help us to check our hearts. Help us to really see what kind of flavor and savor we've given to people around us, even to ourselves, and get right with you, Lord God. And thank you for giving us this opportunity. And at least, Lord God, you know, you have given us this miracle-ness of salvation. Thank you so much that we won't have to burn in hell, Lord. But help us to be that salt to this lost out there. I pray for those who are not here and those who are not doing well physically, Lord, please heal them according to your will. And I pray that we'll be out there and be a good testimony for you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.